Okay, 7 o'clock. I think I'm done. I'm actually getting ready to put on my costume. Task I'm getting ready to put on his costume. We have them all laid out right here. If I'm ready to go, I'm gonna get mine, and then you'll see the next vlog. That's gonna be when I put it on, then we're gonna leave. So, yeah, let's get this ready to go. I'm so excited. I'm so excited. I'm like a girl on Christmas. I'm like a little kid on Christmas. Kid in a candy store. Okay, so I'll see you in the next vlog. Okay, you gotta put the black shirt on first.
I just say I'm looking
Okay.
rich.
Okay, so I got my costume on, got his costume.
And I look different.
Yeah. Let me just switch the camera. Look at that. All dressed in the black with my, and then my blade.
This is my first convention, so I don't really know what to expect from this.
That's gonna be f. We did the last one. I gotta go get my wig. I'm a vlog you when you get your completely on. Take that. Actually, change the shirts. Okay, so boots. Yeah. I'm gonna go grab. I'm grabbing Matt Pat sword. Matthew sword. Is that name?
Feels like one though. There you go. Exactly.
Yeah.
Is it supposed to hang or is it supposed to lay?
It's actually supposed to be closer to the waist.
We actually need to lower it. Right now it's just tightening my ribs up and chilling my fabric.
Okay, so I brought your sword down with mine. And so this is gonna be so much fun! Oh, I'm so excited!
My gut's trying to eat it.
Sorry, Matthew.
Yeah. Is that right?
Yeah. Yeah, so.
No, you gotta go.
You want the eye patch too? I haven't bought the Kaneki mask that Tyus didn't want to wear though.
It's hanging down. I didn't know it high enough. I don't think.
It's fine, it's fine, it's fine.
They're supposed to cross over.
But, it's
fine. Kenpachi's all on the one thing I suggested because he's not like one of the captains where it's got to be bright. No, it's all
just throw it on.
Yeah, because that's what he is. So I gotta do the wig. My wig.
It's pretty much massive besides I'm the only one though that have a sword.
Yeah. I forgot him, I'm sorry. I was too busy making sure you had the costume.
Yep.
Drinking.
Well, at least I smell good. Buffalo.
Wow, yeah,
I'm so excited for this.
Is that him running?
Yeah, this is him running.
Yeah, this is him running.
This is my standing still running.
I need to make it stand up.
Okay, it's not like you're.
It's fine, it's fine, it's fine,
not,
it's fine.
You can't make it exactly like the anime.
Kenpachi's is always stuck back anyway.
Yeah, sometimes it leans back like that. It leans at the very tip. Trust me, you can't copy anime. They draw that. It's supposed to go stay short.
You can't
it's real
life. You can put real glue in my hair.
You can.
All
right,
boys. I think you look kind of too long.
I gotta get dressed.
This
I
is
got too long.
We're good. Go get dressed. We're gonna stay.
Hey, go here. Right. Put these on. Let's see what your sandals. We gotta pull things.
I'm gonna be like this.
Yeah.
Right. We're gonna go off stage. I'm gonna be like this.
You need to get your belt like this so you can hold your sword.
To walk
well, Benny, yeah, he's staying in the middle because we got the same outfit.
I'm gonna stay in the middle. I'm gonna put two above his head and one above you.
You wanna take the picture?
You're season one, he's season two.
You wanna take the picture for the thumbnail?
He's fixing to get his
Because we gotta take a picture for the thumbnail of this one.
Talking about my head,
because the videos we put thumbnails on them because the.
Oh,
you know the little picture you see whenever you.
I know what you're talking about now.
Before you click on them, yeah.
Yeah, I know that thumbnail.
So, My costume.
Who would ever thought Kim Pike would get a laid back in leather?
Yeah.
So unrealistic.
We're doing pretty good. We're doing pretty good for the Xbox. Right.
Hey, Mama, I need your help.
Here, hold my camera. I'm gonna fix it. I'm gonna fix your set, the set piece.
What I'm doing?
Where'd she go?
I'm right here.
Come here. I can't reach
my
feet.
Oh.
I can't reach your feet.
So. You're the season one. I'm Brad. I'm season two and the movie.
Look, whenever you do the thumbnail, you need to go to that picture thing you got and put season one of season above my finger and then season above the other finger so they know.
I'll add them in there. So, this and that. Okay, so we're gonna end this vlog here. Okay, I'm doing it. Come on. I can't see nothing.
Why is it like picture switch?
Okay. Oh, no. You ready, Matthew?
I've been ready.
It's been going
for
11 seconds.
One. I'll take it.
Yo.
Tires.
My hair is limp.
Yeah. My wig. More like I'm gonna take it off, but yeah. Delta Fan Fest.
Woo!
First one ever. Hopefully I have a lot of fun.
Okay.
Man, you should if it's like the last one.
Hey. I hope.
But if it's like Jeez. The last one, it's going to be a bunch of high-tech ones.
Yeah, take a picture of that now. It's going to be so much fun.
Woo!
I'm in this one, and we're going to be in the next one. Okay, here you go.
More money.
Yeah. Why, you want to buy some? Okay, give me, here, hold my sword. Okay, this is actually getting crazy fun already. I'm loving this.
Here, put it on your belt.
Oh, this?
Yeah, put the sword on it. Never mind.
Okay, I'm gonna go talk to the Lois and Clark dude. Look at all this place. A lot of people haven't actually successfully gotten it yet.
It's
yeah, man, just have a look at this place. The point of the vlog, right? Okay, to start out. Huh?
More serious,
but. Yeah, I know, but to find out there's not that many, like, actual, like, there's them, and there's not that many people actually here.
Huh?
But, yeah, it'll get bigger later on for the day. So, yeah. Excuse me. Okay, I'm gonna go meet the, like, Dean Cain, the dude who plays Lois and fucking Superman. He's the Supergirl's father in the Supergirl show, and he's got a part in Smallville, so I'm gonna go see him. Okay, I'm gonna find Matthew and Dias. I don't know where they went.
Somebody told me he's actually
in here. Where you go? Oh, there. How you doing? Come on.
I think it's a good idea.
It's the guy with the brown coat.
Bam!
Did you make that?
Oh.
No, all of
How are you enjoying it so far?
Good.
What you, Taz?
Pretty fun.
Also, for I'm getting tired of
it. I wish it was more active, though.
Yeah, like there's not any people. Even though, like, I'm waiting to, like, meet her. She's on, what's her three parts? Attack on Titan, Full Metal Alchemist, and, oh, she did her? I did not know that she did,
Oh, she dog.
She's Mikasa, but I didn't know she,
She's also in Soul Blade.
Yeah, but I didn't know that she was her. In Full Metal Alchemist.
Oh, now I definitely got
that. That's crazy. Let's zoom in on that.
I still remember when those toys were coming out.
He's off.
She did what?
Gate.
What?
She's in Steins Gate, Evangeline.
Oh, she is Steins Gate person. That's cool.
My Hero Academia.
She played as her.
Hey, look, she's even in Attack on Titan High School. Junior high?
Yeah, I know, because she's Mikasa.
Oh, I know that, but still. She wants to sound good.
She played her
first. Does she have an SAO character?
Look at this.
She played
this.
Her.
Yeah, she played the actual voice.
Look, she was the big girl from Trigun.
Cool.
And she was her for Heaven's Lost Property.
She's dead alive.
Dead alive too.
Okay, here, hold my sword real quick.
Ooh, Dimension W.
Seraph of the End too. It's
time. Oh,
she's every anime. Look at this. Sex
pitch. I did not even know you played any of the characters.
Just about played all of our favorite characters.
Thank you.
Yeah, like you literally did. You got. Okay, we just met the voice actor Mikasa.
And a lot of my
like a lot of anime characters she does. More than I thought it was possible. It is phenomenal and amazing, and I just am happy to do it. Sorry. I forgot to make a sheath. Wha-ching! But it was so much fun. I'm enjoying this already. Okay, when you get done, hit that button right down there. This recording. Cause you're gonna put it. We're gonna add this into the vlog. Come on.
Yeah.
How you take a picture?
You hit the little circle at the bottom.
All right. Got it.
Thank you. Okay. So, Matthew, just add your applause into it.
Huh?
Say something.
Something.
Okay, that was good. Though. You say something.
Yeah.
Okay.
I'm gonna drop my balls.
Nah, funny. Okay, so like,
I can't drop yet.
We came close to winning. I was at least inside of the
lightning round.
Yeah, I was inside of lightning round winning. We got like two balls.
And we got four balls.
Yeah.
I got two, and Ty's got the other two.
Yeah.
Ooh, look at a Gundam.
Yeah. Okay, so that is done. This is done.
I didn't notice until I did it.
I want that SEO shirt. Huh?
How much is the shirt?
I don't know. Not she shirts her.
Look at the paws.
Yeah.
Look at the Neko Power symbol. They got the paw.
Yes. Okay, so with this all working out, this vlog's working out. She loves Nekos.
College is a close second, and I really enjoy college football.
Right. Well, I was going to ask about the Bills, of course. I just want to make sure you're still a Bills fan. Do you still have your, allegiance to them?
They're the only team that ever paid me in the NFL, so I like them a lot.
Right.
Absolutely.
Okay.
My favorite team, though, in the NFL is Dallas Cowboys. I know.
Well, we're in the South. There's tons of Dallas Cowboys.
The reason I like that, one of my closest friends is the head coach of the Cowboys, Jason Garrett. He was my quarterback in college, and he's a great guy. And I've always enjoyed, rooting for the Cowboys anyway. So him being there for the last 6 years now, I guess, it sort of solidified that. So I'm rooting for the Cowboys. I actually bet on them to win the Super Bowl.
This year?
40-1 odds, I'll tell you.
Oh, hey.
Hey, it was worth a couple bucks to throw out there, just in case.
Yeah.
It's a win-win.
All right, so we hear all the time about athletes, about the highs during games, and when they get out of the sport, they can't seem to replace it. So how do you compare acting to the highs of football?
Actually, it's a huge similarity. It's great. You get the same sort of feel. You know, it's really the same kind of high. It's the same rush, it's the same excitement. That feeling you get before a big game, you know, those butterflies in the pit of your stomach and that excitement before the first hit, you get that when you're going to go step out and do a scene, you know, with Denzel Washington. You're like, okay, here it is. So you get that same excitement, that same sort of situation. And then you end up, you know, whether you're hosting a, you know, something at for the Emmys or the Golden Globes, or, you know, there's that excitement to be up in front of a live group and you know, even give an award or things like that. So there's a lot of similarities to that. It's sort of game time. It's a lot of fun. And fortunately, you know, the thing about being an athlete and then not having that anymore, that's a really tough thing for a lot of those guys to go through, because it's intoxicating. That rush, that excitement is intoxicating. You want to have that again. So I feel bad for those guys who don't get that opportunity after college at all. You know, I mean, or after the short stint in the NFL or whatever it happens to be. Some of them only get into high school, and it's a bummer. But as an actor, it's the same sort of feeling, and it continues on through. So I feel pretty blessed in that sense.
All right, so just be honest with us. Would you trade your acting career to make it to the Super Bowl as an athlete?
No way, man. Well, you know, if I'd have stayed healthy and made it with Buffalo, I would have seen four Super Bowls in 5 years, and that would have been outstanding. The thing is, the reason I wouldn't trade it is the acting career is such a long career. I feel like I'm in the, you know, it's still in the beginning parts of my acting career, and you can continue to do it forever. I could play a football player forever, instead of having to learn to do something really well, whether it's ice skating or something with a weapon or whatever you're playing, whatever your character is. So it's great fun, and I would not trade that for anything.
All right. Okay, so let's move on. Let's go to the current right now. Are you allowed to tell us anything about Supergirl Season 2?
I'm alive. Right. I'll tell you that. Jeremiah Danvers is alive. And well, we saw my eyes pop open at the end of Season 1. And yeah, he's alive. So I'll be there. I will appear in Season 2.
In some form.
Absolutely. Yeah. I can absolutely guarantee that. I can't tell you what form or when. I might have told somebody or a couple folks here today that maybe unofficially it could be this day or whatever. But yeah, so I'll be showing up for sure.
All right. Are you aware of the differences of shooting in Vancouver versus LA?
Oh yeah, I've shot 9 or 10 movies at least in Vancouver. I shot Ryan, thank you. So you know, those guys get those suits with all the different, you know, doohickeys and stuff. I had tights. We're a television show. You know, we didn't have the budget for that. So it was uncomfortable to some degree, of course, because you're in it and you're just cruising around. But, you know, at 27, I didn't care.
How many suits did you have?
Probably had about eight suits. They were all just the same. We just switch them out. It was a lot of hot weather. If you started sweating in the suit, it would show up. And fortunately, I'm quarter Japanese. I'm not a hairy dude, so I didn't have that problem. Tyler Hoechlin, who's currently playing Superman on Supergirl, when he got cast, I had to comment on it because he's got a really hairy chest and it's like coming up over the top there. I'm like, hey, you can't have that. Superman can't have a hairy chest poking over the top of his S. So I'm sure he had to wax that sucker or do something. I haven't seen him yet as Superman, but I'm interested to see it. And he's a good actor, so I think he's going to do a great job. But I don't know what he has for his suit either. I haven't seen his suit. I don't know if they faked it out or whatever, but for me, it was just spandex, Lycra. So if you want to know what that feels like, just get in at home and go, yeah. A little tough.
All right, so hypothetically, since the CW's got the 4 shows now, all in the same universe, how cool would it be, just purely hypothetical, if you were in a scene with a lot of the superheroes?
Oh, for me, that'd be great. Listen, I love the whole world. You know, I love the superhero world. I love the superhero mythos. You know, I like to be part of it. That's why I did Smallville. That's why, you know, when people are like, oh, do you get mad when people call you Superman? I'm like, yeah, that just sucks. It's terrible. Quit calling me that.
Yeah, there's so many worse things to be.
Call me Scott Peterson. I like that better. It's like, you know, of course I like being called Superman. I don't mind that at all. It's not an awful thing to be called. And I mean, I've done 100-and-something movies since. I don't worry about that in my career. I can make movies. I can do things and play other characters. But to have an iconic role like that and be part of it, I embrace it. So anytime that I can be a part of that world, I'm more than happy to. And Christopher Reeve did it. He did it on Smallville. When he did Smallville, I was like, you know, if they ask any of us, we sort of had to because he's the lead. You know, we follow his lead, and I had to for sure. So if I can be in there with a bunch of superheroes, great fun. I you know, it'd be nice if I could, you know, crush them all, but I don't think that'll happen.
Well, you never know.
You never know. Yeah,
until the script comes in, you never
exactly.
know.
I may have seen a script or two, but I don't know.
Yeah. All right, so since you brought it up, I do want to talk about Scott Peterson. So if anybody here doesn't know, Dean Cain played Scott Peterson, infamous.
He's a very infamous fellow, yeah. So, he was convicted of murder of his unborn child, and Lacey Peterson. That's an awful story. But.
So I just want to know, how did you get into that role? Were you able to talk to him, or, you know, kind of?
I went to San Quentin, I sat down with him, I said, just tell me, did you do it? Shh, I won't tell anybody. No, I did not meet him. I didn't. In fact, we were shooting that film at the same time he was going through his pretrial hearing. So we would learn things while we're watching TV at night that were going to affect the next day's shooting. It was really odd. And we wanted to make sure he hadn't been convicted. So we wanted to make sure we didn't convict him. So we kind of don't give you answers, but we just show you what happened. And it's all well documented what happened, with the things that took place. So it was interesting as heck. I turned down the role probably 4 times just because I didn't want to be associated with that guy. He's a real guy, and it was you know, contemporary. It was happening right then. And my agent was like, you know, I don't want you to be getting chased up and down the street with pitchforks and flames. You know, like, hopefully they would not do that to me and confuse me with the character. But then my dad finally said to me, you know, is it something you could do? Could you be good at it? You know, and I said, actually, yeah, I think I could be really good at it because I look similar. And I think I got his whole thing down because he was like, I always joke and say that when you watch his interviews and things, Scott Peterson just looked like a bad actor. And I was like, I can do that. It's done. And then my dad said, you know, you could be good at it. And I said, yeah. And then he said, are you an actor? I was like, yes, sir. He's like, go to work. So then I finally took the job. It turned out well. The movie was good. And it doesn't convict, but it does show his odd behavior and the things that he had been doing around it. And obviously he had an affair at the same time and hit all that. And, was certainly a narcissist, so it's an interesting. I use it as a barometer for dating now. If a woman ever like sees me and she's like, "Oh my God, I loved you in Scott Peterson," I'm like, "See you later, and bye."
All right. So, can you let us know was that the most psychologically challenging role you had, or if not, what was?
No, I don't think that was the most psychologically challenging role because you kind of couldn't tell what was going on in his head all the time. You weren't quite sure. So that was where we had to be very careful. I don't know, what was the most psychologically challenging? I don't know. One of the hardest ones, emotionally anyway, was the thing called The Way Home. And I dealt with, at the time, my son was probably 5 years old or 6. And what happened to this family is their child went, it was in Georgia, and their 3-year-old just wandered off, and they had a very big property. And their parents lived real nearby, and the 3-year-old had 4 kids, and the 3-year-old wandered off and they couldn't find him, and they had to bring everybody in and find him. And just that fear of being without, not being able to find your child is as a parent, and there's a lot of parents out here, I'm sure, it's the worst feeling in the world. And the whole thing took place over a full day, so we just kept having to be in that headspace. That was horrible, because it's just so vulnerable and so awful. So that was one of the most uncomfortable headspaces to be in, just because I was constantly reliving, like losing a child or not knowing what you're doing, and the guilt and all that. Oh, it was terrible. It's a good movie. If you ever see it and you want to tearjerk, go ahead.
All right, before we open up to questions from the audience, I just want to ask, Dean, is there any upcoming projects you want to promote, get the word out?
Well, I got
other than Supergirl season 2, maybe.
maybe. Yeah, Supergirl's fun. Masters of Illusion is a show that I have. It's on still now on the CW, which is I host it. It's a magic show. It's a lot of fun. It's just fun to watch the fun half hour. There's a show called Lady Dynamite that's on Netflix now. It's silly comedy. It's funny. And then what else? I have something else going on. I forgot what it was. That's what happens when you get past a certain age. And I'm starting a movie next Friday with Melissa Joan Hart. It's like a Hallmark type film. And it's I don't like the title. I'm not sure what the title is yet. It's either Love in the Newsroom, boo, bad title, or Christmas Broadcast, because also a bad title. But it's with Melissa Joan Hart. So that's actually a very funny, very cute Christmas time script. That's a lot of fun. So I'm shooting that. And then maybe going to shoot some Supergirl. I don't know, maybe not.
Yes, I'm definitely going to be.
All right, so if you're in the audience and you have a question for Dean Cain, just come on down. And
I did notice you raised your hand back there a little bit ago, young lady.
Yeah, could
you play the... Oh, he's going to come over to you real quick.
When you played the part of Scott Peterson, did you not get emotional at any time?
You know, no, not really. The things that I remember about playing Scott Peterson was he felt sorry. It seemed like he felt sorry for himself. It was a weird thing. I didn't see any remorse in any. And I saw so many of his interviews, and you know, you're sort of coached when you have a PR interview. The things that they want you to say, there's certain things they want you to hit, and certain, you know, it's like being a presidential candidate. They want you to stay on message and say these certain things. And what was really interesting about him was that, just notice your muscles, sir, those are impressive. I was like, wow, look at that. That's outstanding. Yes, sir. And you notice that they want to stay on message. That's what Scott Peterson always did. They would ask him a question about, you know, was it odd that you went fishing on this day or whatever, and he'd just start saying the things that he was programmed to say. It was really odd. So I didn't find anything that was emotional other than him feeling sorry for himself. Really.
Knowing the whole story as far as Lacey and the baby, did that not get any of y'all like really emotional when y'all was playing the part?
Well, at the time we didn't know all the facts. We didn't know if he did it or didn't do it. He hadn't been found guilty. I don't think they'd even found the body yet at that point in time. So the bodies were missing and they didn't have anything. So we were unsure. So we were very careful not to convict him before he was convicted. At the same time, we were just sort of replaying things that had happened and just putting it in sort of a linear fashion and letting everyone else look at it. They tried to stop us from putting the film out. I think her family tried to stop us from putting it out. So that was the tough part for me, is I didn't want to offend her family. But I felt like that it was a story that was a good one to make. I thought telling the story, as tough as it was on the family, I'm glad we made it. But yeah, I never felt that real, never felt really emotional about it, to be honest, other than feeling bad for himself, just playing Scott.
Hi, how are you doing?
I'm doing well, sir. How are you?
All right. Well, I just wanted to try not to geek out or anything.
You're at a Comic-Con. You're supposed to be.
I just want to say I really appreciate you entertaining me all these years. You were the first Superman actor I really got to know from the TV show. I knew Christopher Reeve, you know, and everything, but I really grew up watching the TV show, so I just really do appreciate you entertaining me all those years.
Thank you for that. I much appreciate
it. Thank you, sir. And my question is, what would you say is the most challenging part about playing Superman?
That's a good question. And I think, you know, and I'll use Melissa, Benoist, who currently plays Supergirl. There's something about an innate goodness and like a niceness and a kindness that should exist in the character. And no offense to Henry Cavill, but it's not in his character. It's not there. They're not playing that. That's the one critique I have about, you know, I see Superman, Supergirl, as a character of hope and light. And the darkness of it in the current incarnation is just, it's a little hard for me to swallow. So that's the thing that they don't have, is that goodness and that light. And that was the hardest part about it. You have to have that sort of in you. And if you don't have that, I think it's real tough to play the character. So having that likability and being just a good person, and Melissa is doing a heck of a good job with it. I think that's one of the most important things and one of the most difficult things to get. And like I said, I don't think they're doing that in the current incarnation. Henry is not trying to do that, but I think it's I think he'd find it very difficult if he had to be honest. He's very good at playing the brooding guy and that sort of thing, but yeah, that's the hard part, that innate goodness.
Thank you. Hey, I just have a photograph I want to give to you.
Oh, yes, sir.
This was from Dragon Con in 2012.
Oh, my. Oh, down in Atlanta. Yes, sir. Thank you. I appreciate that. Besides the camera on Harvey, couple cameras too. You're for real. That's why this thing is printed out so well. Thank you. That's very cool. I get free stuff.
I appreciate that. That was a good one.
Yes, Dean. If you had one day with Superman's powers, what would you do with your time?
Woo! There'd be a whole lot less injustice in this world, I'll tell you that. There's no doubt about that. That'd be where I'd go. You know, I'd go towards straightening out some injustice. I suppose ISIS would be gone. things like that. I just that's a heck of a question. Never really thought about that, but that's certainly right. A lot of injustice. That's kind of Superman's his whole motto, if you will. So truth, justice, in the American way. So I would certainly write a lot of injustices, and it's unfortunate, you know, there's so many that don't get sort of straightened out in our current world, and it's unfortunate, but that's definitely what I would do. I can't, you know, can't get too specific about it, but I would spend my time doing that.
If you could choose just one of his powers, which one would you choose?
Oh, for me personally, I'd take the flying. I don't like flying so much in airplanes. They think about it. Those things weigh, you know, 15, 10, who knows how many thousands of pounds of metal, and that's full of gas and people and flies. Really? It doesn't make any sense to me. I understand lift and drag and all that stuff, but it doesn't make any sense. So I don't, and I fly all the time. So I would take flying to be able to get from one place to another in an awful quick period of time. I would take that in a heartbeat. Occasionally I'd go for the X-ray vision, but I don't. Get arrested here in Mississippi. There he is. The Titans, Frank Wycheck. I remember that place so well. The Music City Miracle. He has beat the Buffalo Bills.
And it was a legal lateral, by the way.
It was really
legal.
No clapping. It was awful. Frank Wycheck, number 86.
I know I met you out there, but I have, yes, sir. I have a question. You played Superman, probably one.
Tell where this one's going already.
If you had to play an iconic villain, who would you like to play?
Man, I'll tell you what, villains are so much fun. You know why villains are fun? Because they have fun. They just don't have to follow any rules and they can have a good time. Heck, I don't know. Who would be great? I mean, I like some of my favorite, like, do you remember Die Hard, the movie Die Hard? Remember Hans Gruber? Like that guy, that's the kind of villain I want to play. Somebody who has a good time being bad. So that's what I'd go for. I don't know. In the superhero world, I don't know what that would make me or who that would make me, but Lex Luthor. Lex was so dark, though. I mean, he was always so, I would like to do it with more. Well, I guess the one on Smallville. Did he play it that dark? Michael Rosenberg, was he that dark? Was he? Yeah.
No.
Not in the beginning, but he turned dark. That's just because he was sick of doing the show. I would like to be a villain that had a lot of fun doing it. So I don't want to be as crazy as the Joker. Don't give me credit. But somebody who really enjoyed being bad and could do it with a little bit. Two-Face, beyond. Metallo? He's all done up, though. And he's all, I don't know. I'm going to work on that one.
I got one more question.
Yes, sir.
You mentioned the movie earlier, Vendetta. I'm a big wrestling fan. How was it like to work with somebody as big as the Big Show?
If any of you all haven't seen that film, it's called Vendetta, and Big Show is a gentleman named Paul White who is in the WWE. He's 7'4". Just when you get to that size, it's like he's the size of a tank, and he probably weighs 400 and something. I mean, it's just such a big dude.
500 pounds.
Yeah, it's see. 7'9", weighs 1,000 pounds.
You
when you're working with somebody that size, it's just shocking. And I'm used to being around big NFL players and things like that. When you look like, you know, Bruce Smith and things like that, you're like, that's a big man. He looks small next to Big Show. It's just crazy. And he would be, you'd be in there talking to him after about 15 minutes, you somehow get used to his size. He walks out to go to the bathroom or something, comes back in, you're like, oh, dang, did you grow again? I mean, it's just, he's just so large. The first thing about that show is because we had to fight each other a lot. And we started doing some fight choreography at the beginning. I'm like, no, guys, this is, I mean, look at, I gotta like shoot him or something first, like shoot him in the leg. So literally the first time we fight, I have shot him in the leg before we even started. It was a lot of fun, great talent. He's a very talented actor. A lot of those guys coming out of the WWE because they do so much talking on the mic, they're very good and they can act right away. He's a very good actor and he's gonna have a good career as an actor. Whenever he decides to hang up his singlet or whatever they use in WWE. But he's a great guy, a gentle giant. I actually punched him square in the face one time during a take. Didn't mean to. And I hit him square in the head. And he got him, looked at me, and I froze. I was like, and he just goes, come on. I was like, I don't know if that means you come on, let's fight, or come on, keep shooting. Can we cut? Please, because I'm a little scared. I might have just wet myself a little tiny bit. And let's just clean that up and move on. And when he just wanted to keep going, because he's used to that. They hit each other by mistake, sometimes on purpose, but yeah, hit him square in the face, and they're just like, come on. I want to stop now. I don't want to play anymore.
Thanks, man.
My pleasure. Yes, sir.
All right. Another quick sports question. If the Bills ever make the playoffs, do you have any kind of access where you can get on the sideline?
The Bills will make the playoffs again. Yes. I wouldn't go to Coach Ryan. I would go through the PR department because I don't think Coach Ryan would let me have a deal. But absolutely.
I think there's a vacancy on the staff right now.
I'm going to leave that alone. But I've been on the field before. I was out there. I've gone out for the coin toss. I've been an honorary captain. I've gone out with, you know, we were playing Miami. So I was out there with Jim Kelly and Bruce Smith. And, you know, they had Dan.
Name drop.
Yeah, you know, all those guys. Those are my teammates. I was like, this is so cool. And I'm in, like, cities. It was cool. I like that. And then I do remember very clearly, though, I was standing on the sidelines and Andre Reed caught a little short out right in front of me, just short of the first down, tried to turn it up, and just got blasted right in front of me. And then it was fourth down. So he kind of just stood up and took, you know, a little half step and he was off the sideline. And I just sat there because I knew that had to hurt. And he was just quiet for a couple seconds and he just turns to me and goes, how do you get into that acting thing anyway? And I was like, yeah, no kidding. I don't hurt like that. Nobody ever hits me that hard. But I can get on the sidelines. I think I can work that out.
Hello again.
Hello, Robert.
If there was any other DC superhero you could play, or if they offered to you, which one would you choose?
Wow. That's a tough one. I mean, I'd pretty much take anything they offered me, really, to be honest. I love being in that universe. I mean, the first Captain America, that was Marvel, though, I know. But, I mean, that first Captain America, where he went and did the whole thing in World War II, I watched that movie, and I was like, man, I would have loved to have been a part of this movie, because that was just great. I loved that, the way they did that. I haven't seen the Civil War. Is Civil War good?
Yes. Yeah.
It's pretty much, I get that from everybody. They say, I should see that. It was on the plane. I didn't watch it, though. Let me tell you what. Deadpool was amazing. It was my favorite superhero movie of the year, bar none. Sorry for the children out there who don't understand. But dang, that was funny. Ryan Reynolds was amazing. That was just incredible. But I've seen it like 7 times.
Me too.
But yeah, so I wouldn't even want to try to play Deadpool because it's too good. He's too good. I don't know who I'd go for. I mean, I certainly couldn't play Batman. Yeah, that's just confusing. Although he has some cool toys. It'd be fun to play Bruce Wayne. Like, I enjoyed playing Clark Kent more than enjoyed playing actually Superman. That was more fun to play Clark Kent, so I would imagine it'd be more fun to play Bruce Wayne, you know, as a villain, if you will. That would be kind of fun. I don't know. Let's see what they come up with.
One other one. I know whenever the Flash crossed over to Earth 2, they showed a shot of John Wilson's ship in the original Flash suit. Was there any chance we might see that if you as Superman, you know, in one of the parallel universes?
If they want to pay me for that, I'll do it in the hard way. Absolutely. It's possible. Who knows? I really don't know the answer to that. They constantly surprise me. So I'm sure there's a possibility. But I'm nothing that I'm aware of yet, but it's certainly a possibility.
Thank you. See, that's acting right there. Because I don't believe it. I bet you've seen the scripts already.
I've seen one. That's all I've been to. And I'm not in the Superman suit, so I know that.
You said you liked playing Clark Kent more than you did Superman. Did you really have to wear the suit under the work suit?
Almost never. Not unless we were going to pull it out. And that was a different version. It was just one little thing. I didn't have all the rest of the suit. Can you imagine what the cape would look like underneath, like your shirt? You're like, what's the matter? Nothing. It's just like a Hunchback of Notre Dame. Then. So yeah, we have that because it's light, right? It's so tight. I could have it underneath the suit, underneath a suit and tie, a shirt and tie. But
he said Batman was better, but if I remember correctly, in one of the episodes, Batman didn't have very much security, and he didn't. And if I remember correctly, the Batmobile got stolen in one of your episodes. And
well, I'll tell you what, Batman is immortal. He's a human being. Yeah. And it's cool he has all his little tricks and things. But like, if I go like Batman versus Superman, like that was a long movie, by the way.
It was terrible.
And
I'm sorry.
I did snooze a little bit during it. I'm not gonna lie. I saw it with my son, and we had these really comfortable seats, and I was like, and I said, oh, what happened? And I was like, I know exactly what's going on. But that would have been, if it would have been my version, it would have been a very short movie. Batman, Superman, square off. Done. Finished.
And
done. I mean, because Superman could have taken him out in a heartbeat.
When you were talking about the Captain America and the World War II, it reminded me of that episode, one of my other favorite episodes, was when Superman had to go up against the Nazis.
Yes. We did that in Lois and Clark. That was fun.
Yep.
And they were trying to create a new world order and stuff, and of course, Superman prevailed.
And thank you for that.
My pleasure. Thank you for watching. I appreciate it. Young Michael.
I remember.
A couple good names. I got
two questions. What's your opinion? Trunks on the outside or the onesie?
I like the trunks on the outside myself, because then, you know, you can kind of hide what might be going on. If that makes sense. I don't want to get in too much trouble here. But I'm good with that. I mean, those guys have cooler looking suits, but I still say Superman needs to have the trunks on the outside. Yeah, that's just my own thing. It breaks it up, but it's just the classic. It's the classic. The onesie, you know, I wrestled in high school. Silly men, they're always going to look silly.
And second, was there anything on Ripley's Believe It or Not that you just, even though it turned out to be true, still couldn't believe it?
Man, so much on Ripley's Believe It or Not was so much fun. I love doing that show because I like the strange and the unusual, and people are just hysterical. So to be able to watch those bits and pieces and laugh and roll and just be shocked by people was great. There were so many things that we couldn't show on the show, and even if it was remotely sexual in nature, we had to get rid of it, and that was probably about 60% of the stuff that got sent to us. So we would sometimes just watch that stuff and have like a big powwow and just roll with laughter and have a good time. So I wanted at one point in time to put that out as a too hot for TV version, if you will, because people are crazy. I mean, they do the weirdest things, and it's just so much fun. So we enjoyed that. I enjoyed the heck out of that show. But yeah, there was lots of things that still blow me away. I mean, the things that always got me were the medical miracles. Those things got me, and the historical artifacts that have, you know, when Abraham Lincoln was assassinated, John Wilkes Booth, you know, jumped out and he shot him with a derringer. Well, he had a backup derringer. When he jumped down there and broke his leg, he dropped the other derringer, and I had it in my hand. Like, I had the backup derringer with his name on the handle, and just like, wow, that piece of history was just, you know, that's amazing. That kind of stuff was amazing to me. So those things always kind of blow me away, just to be that close to history, things that affected, you know, everybody. Thank you.
Gene, first off, thank you again for playing Superman. You're the first Superman that I knew growing up, so thank you for that.
My pleasure, thank you. That tells me your age, though, too.
Sorry.
That I'm very old, too.
My question is, what is your favorite memory of working with Terry Hatcher?
Terry. Terry, without a doubt, Terry Hatcher, I think, was the best Lois Lane to ever play.
Yeah.
I think she really was. She was fantastic. She's a very accomplished, just a very, very good actress. And she was she was the best Lois Lane that's ever been on screen. Be it this, you know, the big screen or the small screen. She was fantastic. And she was just just fan. I mean, she was just so good. At the same time, you know, that relationship between Lois and Clark, that to me, that romance, again, that's another thing they don't do in the current incarnation with Henry Cavill and Amy Adams. That romance to me, I mean, I was uncomfortable when they were doing the bath scene. And I don't usually get uncomfortable in scenes like that. I'm just saying. That was just, the romance didn't seem right. And that, and she was so talented at playing that romance and doing that. You know, just being on screen with her was always fantastic. And that chemistry, you don't know if you're gonna have that chemistry in, you know, on screen. You may have, it may think it exists in real life, but when you get out there and start filming, you know, you'll see couples that'll go and film something, and then they look, you look at them on screen, you're like, I'm bored to death watching them being a couple. You just don't know if that magic will be there. And it was there between us, and it was fantastic. And the hugest part goes to her, you know, her ability to be an actress. I mean, her acting ability was fantastic. So I just give her credit all the way through. She was great, and she was what made the hugest part of what made this show very, very good.
Thank you.
I
want to go back to where you were talking about Scott Peterson, about as far as, you know, how it felt to do the role. Well, I don't want to ask you about Scott Peterson, but talking about that, there's a movie that's coming out, and it's Gosnell. I want to ask you about that. I'm sure it was hard. How hard was it for you to actually do that role?
I finished a film called Gosnell, and it deals with Kermit Gosnell, who's an abortion clinic doctor in Philadelphia, and he is in jail now, two or three counts of murder, and just a horrible situation, things that were going on. And this gentleman was it was crazy, the things that were happening there. So that's a tough movie. You know, I play a detective who sort of uncovers the whole situation. And it's a real guy, and it all really happened. So whenever you're playing something that's real, whether it's Scott Peterson or something like Gosnell, you wanna make sure that you do it correctly and with the right weight and not screw it up, because these are real people and real stories, and it just adds a little something more to it. And that film, just because of the nature of you know, it's not an abortion.
Zach, remember this name, John Hyena. Hyena, John Hyena.
And he's married, has three beautiful babies, Maverick, Stryker, and Graceland. Graceland's my favorite. No one's recording this, right? Fantastic. Oh no! don't, just delete that part. So she's just contrary. So with Mikasa, her devotion to Aaron is so deep, and the only time in season one where she actually shows emotion and loses her restraint and forgets about it is when she thinks Aaron is dead, right? And spoiler alert! So in recording that scene, like Ty knew that I was drawing on our friendship for the show and everything, and in recording that scene, my way to get there as a character is to take whatever experience the character is having and then relate it to something in my own life in order to emotionally put myself into a position so that I can voice something in such a way that is, one, believable, two, true to the character, and three, interesting, right? And so basically for a day of work, I pretended that my best friend was dead, which is pretty messed up when you think about it, right? And so after hours of thinking that way, and emotionally and physically, because if you think about the physicality of losing someone, right? It is physical on your being, like your shoulders, the way you stand, the amount of hurt that you feel, and then mental anguish is profound. Especially when you put yourself into such a place that you've not only lost your best friend, and you know, you've also lost you've lost your family, now you've lost your best friend, and now you're going to go and try and defend the world. All of that pressure for a young girl is tremendous, and you put yourself into that place for hours and hours, and then you come out of a small padded room and you're like, oh, this is real life. Like, this is it. So, yeah, I mean, it's certainly something that that can be challenging after recording that scene in particular. And particularly, I went out to my car and I just sobbed for a while, just to kind of release all of the nonsense and all of that physicality and mental stress and everything else. And like, I actually called Ty and I was like, Ty, I just wanted to tell you that I love you. And he's like, are you recording that show? Are you driving?
No, I'm not driving.
That's fantastic. I'm going to go back to work.
Okay.
It must be weird being my friend sometimes. Or awesome. I don't know which. I'm going to go with awesome. I'm going to hope for awesome.
Have you ever voice acted in an anime and got cut out of it?
Yes. It was awful. So sometimes, that's only happened to me once, thankfully. Knock on wood. Is this wood? This is worth knocking on some wood. I think that's particle board. We'll go with that. So yes, I was recast once in a show that why was I recast? I think I actually booked another gig, and so I wasn't able to finish the show, I think. But it wasn't that big of a role. It was a supporting character. But sometimes that happens. I mean, there are times where you're in a movie and you're an entire character, and maybe you're kind of important in the movie, and they'll just be like, oh, we need to shave 20 minutes off. That girl, never liked her, cut her out, you know? It's the director's prerogative, and that's how it happens sometimes. Womp womp. Just don't take your grandmother to see it, right? Like, Grandma, I made this movie, and it's like, oh no, you can. I'm sorry. Yeah.
Have you ever Googled yourself?
Googling yourself is a very healthy and normal practice. It does not make baby Jesus cry. No? No? Come on. Come on. All right. Yes, I have Googled myself. I think that there's a very real fear that I have that somebody's going to, I think probably it's karma, because I frequently like play silly jokes on other, like on Ty or somebody like that, where I like send funny pictures of him that are doctored or altered in some way. So sometimes it's like, I wonder if anyone's been putting mean pictures of me up. I'm gonna Google. So that's kind of fun. It hasn't happened, thankfully. Like, I don't have any, like, ridiculous pictures. I mean, there are some ridiculous pictures of me being like, and I guess I was saying something. And for a while, I decided that before every panel, because people frequently are like, it's like, I'm here, it's okay. Experience me in real life. I would take pictures, like unexplainable pictures, you know, like, oh my God, Trina on the floor, or like Trina with her head in a trash can. Random funny things that I was like, you're gonna have to explain this, internet, go ahead. But yeah, so that's about it. Do you Google yourself? I think I Google potential boyfriends more than myself. I mean, ladies. I mean, you give a girl a smartphone in 30 minutes and she will know like your entire background. Like, speeding ticket, 2005. I know. Like, you know, we know. Ladies know.
Yes, apart from Attack on Titan, I remember you played a character named Mari Makinari Illustrious in the Rebuild of Evangelion movie series. What was her character like?
Insane. She was crazy. Who's seen Evangelion? Yes, yes. It was awesome to be able to play a girl that was so, because her intentions and her motivations are so mysterious, that I got to just be like off the wall with her, right? Because we don't know. We literally don't know. So her, to be able to be like singing a happy song one second and then ripping your own arm off the next second was really fun and liberating. And her screams are so guttural and so animalistic that if you just save up all of that rage from traffic, just save it, put it in your stomach way down deep until it's time to scream, and then saying just effing die when they screaming it. Oh, it was so good. It was so good.
Don't do one.
You want to hear the scream?
Yes, don't do the scream.
I would like to. However, I would also like to speak for the next 2 days. And I record all week next week. It is a pretty intense scream. The scream that I did for that in particular moment, I actually almost burst the microphone diaphragm, which is super rare and is like jet engine sort of screaming. I didn't speak for an entire 2 days after that scream because it was so, because I mean traffic. Am I right? Dallas is the worst. I understand road rage. I just use a microphone to get mine out. That's me, though. Who has some good shoes? I haven't asked you a question.
No question.
I have two, if you don't mind. That was one. What's your favorite character on Attack on Titan besides Mikasa? Derpy Titan? You guys know Derpy Titan?
Which one?
He like comes around the corner and he's like, and like he like steps on somebody, but he doesn't even like know he's doing it. He's just like, darn, 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 darn. And then I killed him. But yeah,
I love that.
I think he's hilarious. Like, Bryce and I, whenever we see each other, I'll be like, do it! He'll go around going, so good. He does derby diving, like, legit.
The next one is, what would you do if you were in Mikasa's situation?
What would I do if I was in Mikasa's situation? I would probably die. I mean, I think we'd all like to be like, oh yeah, I would totally join the Corps. I would fight Titans. I'd be amazing. I would be awesome. In reality, I would be girl A, who like is like at the market one day and is like, oh my goodness, these oranges look great, Bethany. Look at these oranges. They just smell, and then like splat, you know, like just completely oblivious, and the wall comes down like boulder, boom, like first 30 seconds of the show, dead. That would be me. I'd like to say that I'd be amazing, but I really don't think I would. Like, my zombie apocalypse plan involves a bottle of aspirin and tequila, so that's not funny, is it? I take that back. I do not condone self-harm. But, zombie apocalypse? No, I wouldn't survive that either. I think it's really interesting how since the 80s, really, like all of the, well, I guess since the dawn of time, or literature, how people react to certain environmental things, right? So like 80s, okay? HIV, AIDS, horrible epidemic, horrible, horrible, mysterious bloodborne illness. Early 90s, mid 90s. Oh, a lot of vampire fiction about, you know, bloodborne killers, right? Or bloodthirsty killers. Late 90s, the threat of chemical warfare is very, very real and ever present and always in the news. And then like early 2000s, it's like, oh, some weird virus has taken over these people and turned them into zombies, that you will become a zombie too if you, and even further back than that, you look at tetanus and like animalistic behavior because of an illness or because of a virus, and then there's like werewolves and things like that. So if you think about it like that, like, How are you going to react to these fictions? Like, I just can't. I can't. Like, if there's a vampire, I'm going to die. Because I'm going to be like, oh, you're really handsome. Hi, my name's Trina. Let me Google you. Lestat? How do you spell that? Like, that would be me. I'm dead. Or like, oh, wow. Like, hi, my name's Trina. Like, you, Edward? It's Edward? That's great. Okay. I would be the sucker that's like, oh, it's a zombie apocalypse. I think I should probably go to the most densely populated place then. Like, I shouldn't stay in my house and barricade myself here. I feel like maybe I should go to Lowe's. I don't know. bloodbath in there. I would not do well in the world of Attack on Titan. I would be Girl A, squished, folded, me. Unfortunately.
Where did Girl A get her Titan jacket?
Where did Girl A get her Titan jacket? Oh, this jacket? That is an excellent question. Kenneth Cole.
That was good.
Girl A would not be. That would be unfortunate. It's like, oh, look at the cute girl with the cute little jacket. I guess that's how Attack on Titan is, though, right? You're like, I really, really like her. What was her name? Petra? Oh. Or like, oh my gosh, their love. Their love is so pure and so. Oh. Unfortunate. We were talking about that earlier. Yes,
that was
hilarious.
It was.
What was your most recent voice acting for anime?
Unfortunately, I am not allowed to talk about it. So I know it's the worst. What's the most recent I can talk about? My Hero Academia, anyone? All right. I was like, yeah, all right. So I'm in My Hero Academia. Excuse me. I play Yuro. She's adorable. She has little headphones for ears. So that's the most recent one that I can speak on. If you haven't seen it, please watch it. It's hilarious. That's the most recent that I can talk about. But if you follow me on Twitter, Facebook, or Instagram, then that's usually where I make announcements whenever I can. Sorry. Wolf.
I guess you could say Petra was petrified.
Aww. It's good. It's good. Well, now you know what happens to Petra. Never liked her. That's not true. That's
it. How'd you like playing Aigo in Bakken Test?
Aigo in Bakken Test was really silly. She had green hair. That's it. Aigo was really fun, but we did a lot of her sessions super quickly because of time and how quickly we had to get the show out. So I didn't really spend much time with, this sounds crazy. I didn't really spend much time with her, the animated two-dimensional girl with green hair. I certainly didn't spend as much time with her as I did Mikasa, the animated girl with black hair. I loved it. Anytime you get to do what you love doing, which is for me performing, I love it. I'm very lucky, very blessed. So
Do you ever catch yourself acting like a certain character that you've been playing all day?
Oh yeah, all the time. It kind of bleeds over from her question, right? Like if the entire day recording has been spent putting yourself in an emotionally frazzled situation, then I'm emotionally frazzled. If the entire day is spent crying, I'm a wreck. It's the worst. I played a girl in a movie that I can't talk about. I played a girl whose boyfriend is in love with her, but because of certain circumstances has to push her away. And so she's like chasing him and they're in love and it's really hard, but he's being a douche. Excuse me. I should drink some water. That's what needs to happen. But he's being a douche, right? So I spent all day crying and it was horrible. And then I saw my boyfriend later that night. I was like, I don't know why you're just killing me right now. You're ruining everything. He's like, you said you wanted a tuna sandwich. I said turkey. I said turkey. Just sobbing for no reason. He's like, what are you recording right now? I was like, it's so hard. Just really hard. The next day I went to, I was actually having my friend cut my hair. She's a very amazing and talented hairdresser. And I went to have my hair cut and I was sitting in the chair and I was like, and then he made me a tuna sandwich. Can you believe the nerve? And she was like, what are you recording right now? Like, I just can't talk about it. I'm just sobbing. Actors, emotionally fragile and irrational. Shooting star. All right, some people got that one. That's pretty good. You
sometimes feel like you have personality disorder with all these characters?
Every day.
Such a quick answer.
Like I never knew that people didn't act the way I act. I never knew that people didn't imagine or think about life in storyline. Like everything in my life, like every thought, every experience, every memory, it's all in a storyline, plot pattern. And so it's really hard for, and so my entire life and most of the people that I've surrounded myself with are silly. And, we might be British one second and Irish the next, or not speak any English or whatever character we deem necessary for that moment. And so I didn't know that that wasn't normal. I was a nerd and kind of an outcast. The majority of my youth, and I just didn't care. Like, if they didn't want to be my friend or if they wanted to pick on me, that was fine, because it didn't matter to me because I was having a lot of fun. And so I had no idea what, like, cool kids were doing or how I was supposed to be, because I just wanted to be what was fun and what made sense to me. And so did my friends, who were also in theater. Oddly, we were not cool kids. Because we were like, I don't know what's happening on the footballs, but we're going to do this. And I don't know if you know this or not, but in Texas, if you don't care about the footballs, whew, not great. I always thought that that's just how you thought, and that's just how life was, and that you were constantly imagining different versions of yourself. That's not true, apparently. Apparently not everybody does that. It's always, and I don't think it's a bad thing. I think it's just kind of who I have always been, and I guess who I will always be, hopefully, to just continually imagine different things. Hopefully I won't stop, hopefully, because then I won't work, is what that means. Nope, just me.
Well, if that's all you're worried about, then I'm definitely doing it.
Don't, because it's made of paper.
It's popsicle stick.
Yeah, but it's still going to fall apart. Hardened paper is not the best.
Come on, get a minute.
Matthew, right, don't.
I want to do it. Stop. I probably have something I can hit it with.
Take it all up in there if we can.
My ass hat just messed up.
Chaz, where you at?
Get in here, my black friend. Come on, short.
Ready? Okay, that's probably our final vlog for like this trip until we get home. My phone needs to like unload all this stuff off it.
I gotta guess about it.
Nope. Hold my phone.
Oh.
I'm on his team.
Okay, so I'm doing a final vlog on the laptop, so the screen's a little different. I just got back and the phone died on me, so I got it plugged up. Moved the pitch over here, they're slowly doing their stuff like they should. We got back, I took all the costumes off on that, so I couldn't vlog anymore, but this vlog is so big. 2 hours, about an hour long vlogging speed, so I'm not gonna make the final cut or anything, but we're gonna do like another vlog set tonight, like afterwards, and we've done all that stuff, and probably if we go to back to Matthew's house, we'll do some vlog, we'll probably go vlog there, and stuff, but, yeah, I had to take the wig off halfway too, so that was fun, but this one's gonna take a little while to edit, so I'm gonna log it back up into the computer, and done for tonight. Yeah. Pretty much good in vlogging though, didn't we? Logged a lot today. A good bit. Oh, that's so much fun. Oh, so much fun. So, if you anyone's watched this far into this vlog, I might just split the vlog up or something. I don't know, but I'm also upload the big clips too. Like the big clips with all the people in it. So, thank you for watching. If you watched this far, I hope you enjoyed the vlog of South Haven Delta Fan Fest. Oh, yeah, I'm gonna vlog some other stuff with some more information, maybe, in the future. I might do some game records later for the channel. But, for now, thanks for watching. And I will see you in the next vlog. Bye-bye.